this horse shit over with.
Hey, this is Paul Stanley, and you are listening to Pod of Thunder.
Welcome to Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in KISS podcasting. It's your buddy Andy, America's little brother, and I am joined by Gnarly Nick, the garlic dragon. Oh, a little different noise today. And we are joined by the breakout star of the podcast medium, Chris L. Guys, what's going on over there? Nick's coughing. Chris is evaluating the situation, if he should move away from
couch. It's a nagging
thing. His arm hair is on full display. His upper arm hair, I should say.
Upper arm hair.
Enjoy it.
Yeah. Treat yourself. You don't see it too much when there's 30-degree temperature.
That's what I'm saying. I thought that was put away for a few months. Clearly not.
Arm hair is evergreen.
Yeah, his is.
It's not seasonal, yeah. So, guys, it's Black Friday as we're recording this.
Oh, goodness.
Did you get any deals out there? Did you guys go shopping?
I had nothing to do with anything.
No.
I can't contribute to this conversation.
How about yesterday? You go shopping yesterday?
No.
But okay, but I did. This ought to, I think, make Chris happy. I went earlier today. Went to a kids movie.
So you were off today.
I was off today. Okay. Went to a kids movie, and one of the previews. It's for a movie coming out next year. They sell those ugly dolls. Have you seen those? They're like little plush animals, and they're just, I don't know. They call them ugly dolls. But there's a ugly dolls movie coming out, and the
something else I've never heard.
The
of.
Voice
yeah.
of the
I haven't either.
The,
actually,
the voice of the character that's like the it's like the little dog that's like the little comic relief, little kind of funny character.
Yeah,
voiced by Pitbull.
Ooh.
The man's crossing over into
he's
that world.
He's already crossed over but into he's, every world.
But now it's happening because they've got all the main characters, and then you've got the character all the kids are gonna love
is the Pitbull character.
Is Pitbull, yeah.
Now, what is the character?
Ugly dog.
Ugly dog. And is it a Pitbull?
No.
Okay. They didn't want to be too on the nose.
No,
with
it doesn't look like any real stuff. They look like generic plush animals.
Okay,
but
gotcha.
Yeah, I saw that and I was like, okay, well,
here we go.
Yeah, Pitbull is he's now a voiceover artist for a major motion picture.
He has everyone else already, and now the children.
Now the children. It will be McDonald's will be selling essentially little Pitbull figures in the Happy Meals in a few months. Yeah.
Still annoyed that Fox didn't have the cojones to stick with the New Year's Revolution.
Yeah, that's disappointing. Even though I didn't watch it, it's by far, it had to be the best of the options.
It's the nail in the coffin as far as me even trying to watch any show like that.
That's what I was going to say, because that other stuff is so unwatchable.
Because I say that about a lot of things.
Oof.
In the past couple of years, I've actually stopped watching certain things that all I do is sit there and complain about to my wife
right.
while watching
which
it.
Which you should. You should simply stop watching
like the
it.
Grammys and stuff like
yeah,
that.
It's not for you.
Yeah.
If she puts it on, I'm not going to, get upset, but I'm like, ugh.
You're way out of that demographic.
I have no desire. And now these New Year's Eve shows, like award shows and New Year's Eve shows.
Yeah, that is the right thing, though. Instead of just watching it and complaining about it and tweeting about it and talking about how there should be whatever you like in it, just turn it off.
And these
watch something else.
And these,
it's never been easier to watch what you like.
Well, exactly.
So just turn it off and watch.
Exactly
what you
like. Right. That's another great point.
Go ahead. Nick.
And these parades, like
that's what I was gonna say next. I watched
ten
minutes of that.
I do it every time. Hey, let's put the parade on. Oh, I can't believe this.
It was.
I can't believe how unwatchable this 95% of this is.
I didn't even understand the correlation between anything. It was like, oh, here's the whatever Sargento cheese float with this country star, and then a minute of.
Yeah. Of
like a snippet of this song they're trying to push to make a hit, and then whatever the next, like the things don't even go together, and then it's like, oh, here's this guy rapping, and there's people dancing in pineapple outfits for Dole or something. And it's like, it doesn't make any sense.
Well, it doesn't have to, as long as they get the product placement in there.
And it doesn't matter. Actually, it matters which channel you watch it on. I think it's NBC. It's essentially a Broadway promotional, like a couple hours of Broadway promotion.
That's true too.
Because it's not even things that move anymore. You know what I mean? It's not. Some of the things are floats that actually go by.
Okay, I saw it was
most of the stuff
float.
You see is not stuff that even moves.
Yeah, it's
just here's a camera. There's
ridiculous.
A little stagey area
been destroyed by commercialism. Like, just like the whole holiday season.
Yeah.
So, let's put aside things that'll piss us off. And
here we go.
Get something out of this bag here that'll make us all pretty happy.
Chris came prepared with a bag today.
Came rolling in here with some shit.
I'm curious.
It looked heavy.
I thought it was a bowling ball
heavy.
At first.
Somewhat heavy. Not really, though.
It was taut.
So, are you fans of desserts at all? Did you get enough desserts yesterday?
You know, I had several, and it's not enough.
Yeah,
it's never enough.
It ain't.
As
it better
Stanley
not be.
Once said,
I got
give
some.
Me more.
As Paul Stanley's possibly his last phenomenal great vocal recording. It's never enough.
Okay, so let's see. What I got here is... I got a plate with two creme brulees.
Ooh, now we're talking.
And a banoffee pie.
I've never had banoffee.
You got
to
have
but
it.
But I want
it's good.
To.
Here, you take the shrink wrap off of that.
Yeah.
It's not the first time somebody's told you that.
This colored shrink wrap is a little...
What's that word, banoffee?
Yeah, it's banana toffee, right?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yes.
I've heard of it. Never had it.
Yeah, it's outstanding.
Looks fantastic.
Give me banoffee. Just for
so we can we can split that one. You two can each have a creme brulee.
Banoffee till I'm shaking.
Are you
sure, absolutely.
Can you have a creme brulee?
I'm an
fan?
Everything
yeah.
fan.
Yeah.
Give me creme. Just for bacon.
Yeah, exactly. Now you're in the spirit. There you go. There's creme brulee for
you.
I was
in the paper for creme brulee.
Yeah, you were.
That's right.
How so?
When the Bears were in the Super Bowl last time, I made a creme brulee. And sprinkled dusted powdered sugar over it using a stencil of the Bears logo.
So you white smoked.
I white smoked it. Was in the paper for it, and then the Bears lost.
And then I got some chocolate cake here.
Oh,
look at that!
Just pass that around if you'd like.
Holy crap!
Do it.
Article written by my wife.
The gluttony.
Yes. I was only in there probably because Andy's wife.
Gee, you think? Nothing gets by you, Nick.
I guess I maybe wasn't that well known throughout
Boy,
the community.
What a perceptive individual.
Nick made a
never
a
let
half
it be
dozen.
Said. Never let it be said that Nick can't comprehend what's going on around him and put two and two together.
Man, there's banoffee around me right now. So.
Yeah.
Well...
Can you dash and get some utensils?
I was just going to say, I'm going to have to get some.
And while you're up, you might as well check the front porch because I see some flashing lights going on.
Yeah, let's
Nick's
do things,
got his hands full.
Let's do things a little different today.
Well, you live here. You should be getting the mail anyway.
It should have been happening.
What are we, you got? Aaron boys?
We just realized this 290 episodes in. I should have been doing that.
I'm not doing it very much longer, that's for sure.
All right. Well, I'll be right back.
Yeah, you're going to enjoy the banoffee.
It's overflowing.
It is. It's good. Nothing is... you're not averse to anything that's shown up here tonight?
No.
Do you have a particular palate?
No.
More so than most people that I know.
You mean... no. I mean, there's nothing in any of these wonderful desserts that I have a problem with.
All right. That's good. You never know. You can't just drop a creme brulee on some people and just expect
Which
them
I
to...
Which I don't understand, yeah.
Well, you know.
How that could be the case.
I don't understand why you don't like hot dogs. Well. So that's how that works.
Hey, guys, I'm back.
He's back. He's got spoons for everybody, and he's got something off the porch.
That's right. It's a package.
Anything written on it that we can tell?
I don't see anything.
You know.
Let me flip it over and tell you guys something. I always wanted to do this.
Who's this from?
Who is this
from? Ooh! I don't know. I can't read it. Nick, can you read it? I don't have my glasses on.
Double Platinum Club.
Oh, that's
Mods
right.
Mods of Thunder.
Mods of Thunder. Look at that. Here we go. All right. Well, I don't want to open it, even though I went to go get it, Nick. I feel like we should stick to the plan here.
Let me put the banoffee here.
It would be fun if I opened it, though, wouldn't it?
It'd be fun. Go ahead. You want to do it?
Go ahead.
Yeah, let me open it.
It's your damn house.
Why not? It's usually, Nick usually has some kind of prior knowledge or something. He reads a packing slip ahead of time. I don't know.
Well, yeah.
Seems like it.
Just try something all right. different.
Here we go. All right. Ooh, okay. Mods of Thunder.
Oh, look at that.
This is good. Now, I don't know if this is related to anything. I don't keep a calendar of what's going on in this world.
Well, this is a yearly thing.
It's a yearly thing.
Except so for this year, but that's not stopping merchandising.
Okay. Well, since Disney got the rights to Star Wars, every year there's been a Star Wars movie that came out. For the past,
yeah, like
whatever, four or five
yeah, like
years
around
or something.
December-ish,
around, right? Yeah, with probably, you know, can't get anything by me. Plans for the holiday season, get all the toys out and all that stuff. Make a killing. Well, guys, like Nick said, there's no movie, but Star Wars, full force marketing here. No exception this year. We've got something from the Mods of Thunder collection. Look what we have here. It is... our favorite character.
One of our...
maybe of all time.
One of our favorite running...
running...
I don't know. Running... not. I would. It's not a gag. It's
not
right
gag.
Here.
It's right in front of our
it's
eyes.
It's a running thing, a running gimmick. I don't
yes,
know.
There you go. Real live breathing item. I don't know what you want to call it. But it is Darth Simmons. Oh, it's been a while since we've heard
Darth.
From Darth. Oh, man.
So what do we got?
Well,
what's different?
Well, I don't know.
Just did they just kind of send something to some firmware?
Yeah, I think it's just
some firmware.
It seems like the same exterior, but you know, as we know, this Darth Simmons doll, when you squeeze its codpiece, it talks and gives us a message.
Most dolls do.
So I don't know. Should we just try it, or do we need to sports machine it first?
Yeah, we can.
I think so. Do we?
We can hook it up later.
We'll hook it up later. All right. Well,
maybe we'll even hear some of the old favorites.
Okay. Well, let me go ahead and press this.
This banoffee is a new favorite.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Enjoying it.
Good.
Send some Andy's way. See what he thinks.
Yeah, I have to get in on that.
Careful, there's a little something on the underside. That's what she said.
Did she say that?
She did after she squeezed the cod piece. There's a little something on the underside.
All right.
That's how that works.
I'm going to squeeze this. Here we go.
Andy's cat is wanting to lick my spoon.
Yeah.
Get out of here.
My demo was much better.
Oh, okay.
That's predictable.
It's true. He does say that all the time.
Oh.
Let's see.
It's a matter of opinion, but, you know, it's a way to deflect accountability.
Yeah.
Here comes another one.
Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father. He told me you killed it. No. I am your father.
Not true. No! That's nice for Daddy.
Mm-hmm. Old favorite.
Oh, another.
Bullshit!
Okay. All the classics. All of
yeah,
your favorites.
Two of them, two different sides of the coin, if you will.
Mm-hmm.
Took a long time to get to the punchline of the first one. The second one just cuts right to it.
I think I might need to... well, I don't know. Do you want to do it without loading in the rest of the new ones? Should we listen to another?
Yeah, sure.
And then I can maybe kick on the sports machine and we can flash them.
Sure.
You like that, huh?
I don't know if I like it.
That exhale.
I think he likes it. The push on his codpiece.
Dick.
That was from...
that's what we pressed.
That's from Return of the Jedi, I think.
Is this squeezable codpiece made from leftover materials from the Reebok pump shoes? It kind of looks like that from this vantage point in the room.
I had basketball shoes during that period that had a 3D little basketball on it.
Mm-hmm.
It was not just
ornamentation.
Yeah, but I had everybody, are those pumps? Like, that was a huge thing. The kids, I was like 12 when those came out. A huge deal among all the boys around that time.
Did people want to touch your shoes?
Yeah, yeah.
Did you let them anyway?
I don't remember if I just told them no.
No, they're not pumps. Get away.
They're not pumps. Don't touch me.
Mm. Well.
So what you're saying is, during that period, there were a lot of Reeboks in boys' room.
Yeah, that would have been the period. Early 90s?
Yeah.
Yep.
Those things were all the rage.
Was it early 90s? That long ago, huh?
It had to have been. Yeah.
Absolutely.
So I'm going to kick on the sports machine. Let's get to,
okay.
Let's get to some more of these new ones here.
All right.
I still don't know what is said there in those lyrics. I don't even want to know. It's better that I don't know.
Yeah, let's keep it that way. It's fine. So we've got it fired up.
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to predict anything, jinx anything, but historically we haven't had great luck once that song has come on.
No, but,
Well,
shenanigans, possible. Perhaps?
I don't know. Maybe.
Anything is possible.
Okay. Well, let's squeeze this codpiece one more time. What do you guys say?
Let's do two more.
Two more?
Yeah.
All right, two more squeezes.
Why not? Nobody else has it.
Make it even tighter around our ankles.
All right, here we go.
I give Peter's solo album 0 stars.
Jesus. Wow. Okay.
Outrageous statements coming out of this thing.
But true, but accurate to the subject matter.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's not an inaccurate quote. He said it.
He said it. He just didn't know who he was.
Let's do another one.
Another one?
Yeah.
I'm kind of nervous. What if I do it with my creme brulee spoon? Because I'm kind of tired of touching this codpiece repeatedly.
Make it even stickier down there.
That's right. But it gives a layer of protection between me and the codpiece. Let's do this. Here we go.
People from John Lennon to David Bowie to Jerry Lee Lewis agreed to appear on the record.
Oh, my God.
There it is, the requisite. A secondary blast.
like the car hitting the bottom of the ravine.
Yeah. Jeez. Well, I'm glad I used the backside of the spoon there.
Goodness.
Now, is that another accurate quote? I mean, I've heard talk along those lines. Jerry Lee Lewis, he's alleging, was slated to be on
Jerry
the
Jerry Lee
album.
Lewis probably would have been on, like, Living in Sin.
Yeah, there you go.
Right?
Bing, 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 bing.
Can you play a couple of chords on the piano,
please? That's probably what that was. The intention for that piano piece was. And Jerry Lee Lewis heard it and was like, I'm busy. Even though he had nothing to do in the 70s.
I'm busy. I'm going to have an album in about 40 years.
Yeah. All right. So, do you have good news for us, or do we not have a song this week?
Oh, no. There was a little... piece of the underside of the cod piece.
Oh,
and it has survived.
Yes, that's good news.
And a little Famunda cheese on there.
So wait, is this the end of Darth Simmons? It blew up.
I mean, unless he's got like a Terminator 2 thing going on where he can be scattered about.
You know,
come together.
I thought I was upset when Mr. Rake the Leaves exploded.
Well,
I'm more upset today that really? Darth Simmons is gone. Oh. It's a bummer.
All of the icons of the show are being neutralized as we come to the end.
Yeah. Okay.
Let's just consider the rest of this episode a tribute to Darth Simmons.
Let's do that.
This one comes off.
The Art of McCartney.
It's called
Venus and Mars / Rock Show.
/ Rock Show.
I think I've seen that's it that
you,
way.
That's how you call this one?
Yeah, isn't it technically a medley?
Yeah, it's
two songs in one.
Two songs?
Yeah.
Okay.
No, we're not splitting this up in 2 weeks. We're getting this over with.
Yeah.
It's another questionable inclusion from my standpoint, but the listeners whined about it. So here we go.
It's questionable.
They whined about
it. They did.
It's questionable due to the...
It's a fact. You want to talk about Gene's quotes being factual? Here's another fact. The listeners whined like pussies about it to get things like "Don't touch my ascot" included. Okay, well, here, good. Good for you. Here, you got what you want.
Got what you wanted.
Jag-offs.
You're so mad at them. Yeah.
So this
maybe they deserve it, though.
This album came out 2014.
Mm-hmm.
That recently, huh?
Yeah. Contained, a veritable who's who. I think there were bonus discs and all kinds of stuff.
Bonus discs?
Yeah.
Well, how many damn discs were there?
I don't know, a couple. There's
that makes me think there's
the main release
damn near
50
songs.
34 songs on
the
main release, and then there's bonus tracks.
Okay, that's ridiculous. So let me go ahead and tell you where I stand on this. Not only have I never heard this Kiss cover, I've never heard the real song, and until you said / it's a medley, I didn't know it was two songs.
Oh, yeah. Actually, where I'm looking right now, it's not listed that way.
Okay.
Oh, no, it is. I'm sorry. I think I've seen it both ways. I think I've seen it listed both ways. Sometimes it'll just be called Venus and Mars.
Okay. And then sometimes it's Venus and Mars Rock Show.
/ Rock Show.
/ Rock Show.
Yeah. So some of the people who appeared on this album... They really rolled
Jerry
it out
Lee
here.
Lewis, no. David Bowie. No.
No, okay. None of those.
They all had time to make for Paul McCartney, but...
Billy Joel, Bob Dylan, Hart, Steve Miller, Harry Connick Jr., Brian Wilson, Willie Nelson, Jeff Lynne.
Oh, boy. he had to mention him.
Barry Gibb. Paul Rogers, Roger Daltrey, Def Leppard, The Cure, featuring James McCartney, of course.
Who's that? And
son. Get the
Who's
kid on
that?
There. Totally unrelated guy who, based on his own musical merit, made it onto this
album. Oh, okay.
Couple guys from Cheap Trick made it on the album. Joe Elliott has a solo song on here, apparently.
Great.
Perry Farrell.
Are you going to read everybody?
Just the ones that are interesting.
And you read Jeff Lynne.
Smokey Robinson.
Call your judgment into question.
Smokey Robinson.
That's interesting.
That's fine. I'm saying you mentioned Jeff Lynne.
I did.
But
I mentioned that because Chris is sitting next to me.
Yeah.
You claim that you're talking about people who are interesting.
Well, I found it interesting.
Not fucking hangers, no talent hangers on of other luminaries.
Yeah.
And Sammy Hagar closes out the main release.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
So a veritable who's who.
I didn't know Paul McCartney wrote Up for Breakfast.
So
how do you be above that?
I guess not. I mean, well, lyrically, the song Sammy Hagar does is not much above that. He sings Birthday.
Oh, God.
So, I mean,
it's gotta be terrible.
Up for Breakfast versus Birthday? lyrically speaking, at least. It's a toss-up.
Well, question for you guys. Is this the one, I believe, the whole album like this, where it's not the bands, it's just singers? Well, and then the backing tracks are played by someone else?
See, bands are listed, and I don't know the full... I mean, I'm sure we probably have some people out there who will supply us with the information on social media, mm-hmm. clarify things, but I've never known.
Okay.
I'd heard that it was just Gene and Paul.
That's what I've been told.
And it's listed as Kiss. Even, yeah. I mean, I don't know.
That's what I've been told. That's the way this album was done, where if you want to be on it, it's McCartney's backing band.
And they just sing?
They sing.
So like Def Leppard.
Oh, it's just Joe Elliott, right?
No, but they
did. Or was there also a Def Leppard?
There were both,
actually.
There
were both.
Yeah, there was a distinction made.
Maybe it's guitar solos and lead vocals?
Who knows?
God.
I can't see.
What song did Def Leppard do?
I don't remember. Let me see here.
One of Phil Collins' bullshit guitar solos.
He's got one of the most frantic, ridiculous guitar solos I've ever heard.
Oh, gee. He never plays it like that. He's one step up from CC DeVille.
The live version of the very obscure Def Leppard song, Good Morning Freedom. Seek that out if you want to hear
I won't be seeking it out.
A solo that's incomprehensible.
Is that from that one album where they open for themselves and play a bunch of obscure
stuff? The Vegas
stuff?
One.
The Vegas thing, yeah.
Okay. They do Hell in Wheels, and then Hi, Hi, Hi is a Joe Elliott solo. So, the better song, in my opinion, being Hi, Hi, Hi. But
those two?
Of those two,
I got to disagree with you on that.
Well...
Neither are that great, but, you know, I prefer Hell in Wheels to that.
I'm not going to break.
Andy doesn't.
I'm not going to be the tiebreaker because I don't know.
He doesn't know.
No. I can't carry
Blissfully
this
unaware.
I can't carry this episode like I normally do, so I'm going to have to hand it off to you guys. To
do something else new we're trying with this one.
All the Beatle talk.
So you're saying that McCartney's backing band, who they've been his band for the past decade or so, they play all the music on all this?
That's what I've been told.
Yeah. Probably about 20
and
years.
And that's like,
so,
hey, if you want to do this, this is what it is. It's not bring your song and, you know,
well, I guess
if you're
that's
lazy.
That's one way to maintain a constant mix throughout the album.
Yeah.
So you don't have the...
Yeah, and there's also, there aren't going to be any, chances taken with the versions. These guys are going to play it straight.
Yeah.
Speaking of the Cure, there's not going to be any Cure version of Purple Haze like there was on the Hendrix tribute album.
There's a Hello Goodbye by them and Sea Moon by Robert Smith on the bonus tracks.
Sea Moon?
Yeah.
Who's he?
Yeah.
No, that's the song.
Okay.
I saw McCartney years ago and he played that song and he explained what the sea moon meant.
Oh, good.
I don't know that it's clever enough to actually
it's not.
Yeah.
I was going to say, if it was a bonsai moon, I'd listen to it.
Could have had someone go by in the bug from the Abbey Road cover driving down
exactly.
The stage.
Now, is it possible that the title of that song is Sea Moon? Wow. If so, that is a euphemism for the legendary Bonsai Moon.
Unfortunately, that's not what I heard.
An incredible event that I witnessed.
All right.
Incredible stuff.
Well, any other thoughts on this one? Do you guys like... So, here's another thing. These are two different songs, like you said. Mm-hmm. Can you explain to me the relationship between the two? Is there anything?
I don't know that there is one. It's sort of a... I'm trying to think of another example. It's just two songs. One, they're pretty different.
It's not like this on whatever album it's from, though, right?
Well, it's on... Yeah, it is.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
It's the first two tracks of the Venus and Mars album.
Title track, yeah.
Okay. So that's how it is on the album.
Yeah.
Too. Got it.
And I don't know. I'm trying to think of another example. I know there are some, but right now off the top of my head.
Well, there are songs that have typically been played on classic rock radio, album-oriented radio, where they pl- play both songs.
Yeah, like Queens. Like,
yeah.
Yeah. Feeling That Way Anytime by Journey. Those are two separate song titles. Some would play Sergeant Pepper into with a little help from my friends. They seg right into each other.
I guess Eruption into You Really Got Me. That's another one. All the time. But those are pretty consistent.
Isn't there a Boston one?
Well, Foreplay, Long Time.
There you go.
Yeah, it's along those lines, like separate published titles.
Mm-hmm.
But this is, I think this would be maybe even closer to like the Queen one, where the two songs really don't resemble each other, from what I recall. I haven't listened to this.
Well,
for
there's
a while.
Also the other one is that comes to mind is Heartbreaker, Livin', Lovin' Made by Zeppelin. I just never understood why. Stations felt obligated to play those two songs.
That's true. They
back
do,
to back. I've never heard them separately on the radio.
That's weird. Was it released that way as a
no,
single?
No, they're just no? one after the other on side two. First two tracks on side
two. And it breaks in that immediately at the end of Heartbreaker.
Yeah, I mean, the gap between the songs on the album is admittedly pretty short, but I don't know who decided that you should play those two back to back and never do otherwise. It's kind of strange, but
it's weird. All right,
one of those little anomalies. So I recall enjoying this song on like the Wings Over America live album and the associated live concert film that came out with it that they show pretty frequently on MTV Live these days. So I'm kind of interested in hearing this. I'm not a fan of this format the way you've described it. Because like I said, you're just going to get stock versions of the songs of somebody else singing it.
Yeah.
I mean, have you guys heard The Cure's version of Purple Haze from the Hendrix tribute album?
No.
I had the tape with Winger doing it, but
yeah,
not The Cure.
No, completely different. They completely made it their own. Such a version would be impossible in this format.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
So, yeah, no balls, no chances being taken. What is McCartney above that?
And I don't know the whole story behind this album, but to me, you can draw comparisons to Kiss because the Kiss tribute album, Kiss My Asterix, at least that's the one I have.
Was there a version without that?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
The one I ended up buying at the store had those. But
censored.
Which, that had to be a Gene title, but anyway. They organized it. That was Kiss, let's do our own tribute out.
That actually wasn't Gene's first title.
Okay.
It wasn't. It was actually called Kiss My...
Dick.
Sorry.
Isn't that Lewis Black's catchphrase?
Is it
Kiss My Dick?
Yeah.
That's his... it kills every time.
Oh, I've been saying that for years.
Well, when he gets worked into a frenzy about something, he starts... like stammering and shaking and says, "Kiss my dick."
Yeah,
I've been reversing that for over a decade, probably two decades.
There you go.
Suck my ass would be the reverse of it.
Yeah, and kiss my dick.
You really confuse people when you juggle things up like that.
It is funny how it really doesn't make a difference. It's the same insult, but it's not the one you're used to hearing, so it just sounds funny.
It's like when you call a woman an asshole. Yeah. It's just jarring for some reason.
I love that. Do that all the time.
Yeah. Hey,
almost daily.
You want equality? Guess what? We're calling you an asshole.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah. We don't have to.
How are you
going to
turn that around me and get me fired for that? Good luck to you. You're just an asshole. Yeah. Just like dudes.
Yep. So
welcome to equality, ladies.
Welcome to equality.
Wasn't
assholes.
Yeah. Wasn't all it's cracked up to be, was it? Yeah. You're a SEMO post bonsai moon asshole. Okay. Hairy, dirty, all of that shit.
Man.
That's you.
Wow.
How unladylike.
Yeah. That's, you know, when you want, or you really want to hit somebody. I mean, asshole has been an insult for
millennia,
centuries now, huh?
Millennia.
Probably.
I'm sure, yeah.
I would be willing to bet.
Whatever grunt it was
seeing
for...
You are
that thing.
You are the orifice that releases waste to the human body.
But, yeah.
That's as old.
Cavemen were grunting
I'm
that
sure.
at
yeah.
each other.
Exactly. Pointing at it.
You go look at the hieroglyphics. Oh, yeah, that one means asshole. Pretty sure that's a, you know, archaeologists would confirm that.
So one more last thing before we get into this song. What year did this original...
1975.
Was it? Yes. Wow. Okay. I didn't realize it was that old. I guess it makes sense, though.
Wings, I mean...
The Venus and Mars album, I remember the cover being in the collections of some of the stoner older brothers on the block who I've spoken about on previous episodes, the guys whose record collections we would raid, and that was our introduction to rock and roll. I don't recall us ever really pulling this one out and putting it on the turntable. Just had kind of a cool cover.
We had this one in our basement growing up. And I don't know where it came from. I don't think we ever listened to it, though. I remember seeing it. I mean, I've never heard of any of these songs. Okay.
With the different colored spheres.
Yeah.
Cover.
Yeah. Never did bust it out.
Yeah. We didn't either. We weren't really drawn to it. I don't know. I don't know what to tell you.
Andy's dropping things. Drinking.
I'm sorry.
Goodness me.
Let's get started,
wearing
guys.
His beanie.
Yeah.
Yeah, I came in from being outside, and I thought, I'm just going to leave this hat on today.
Andy's always been a fan of the beanie.
I don't know why that's funny, but it is. Big beanie guy. All right. Let's get started. Does this sound the same as the original?
Yeah, I mean, again, the format of this is, I don't get it.
Mm-hmm.
I don't understand. Well, you know, Beatles, McCartney, Kiss, you got on the line. People are just going to buy it for the sake of who it's about or you know, what the focus is. But it's like, what do you expect to hear on this? I don't know. It's like, I don't understand the appeal, but it's their tribute album. I don't know.
Sitting in the stands of the sports arena, waiting for the show to begin.
It's Gene.
Gene! Doing a Beatle-y voice, huh?
He always talked about his voice, you know, when he was younger, much higher and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah. And if
somebody was squeezing his codpiece.
Yeah, he was about to explode here.
His voice was kind of high on last week's song, Good Girl Gone Bad. He's capable of it.
Mm-hmm. And if you watched Unmasked before... They do that section in there where they're doing their Beatles harmony together. Like they're saying, oh, that's what we used to do.
Exposed.
Not on, I don't know why I said
that. Okay.
I'm an idiot. Where they're talking about how that's what they were doing on a street corner when they were first getting started. Paul and Gene together doing Lennon-McCartney harmonies, singing Beatles songs. And then that's where the take your dollar and fucking beat it clip comes from.
Red lights, green lights, strawberry wine. A good friend of mine follows the star.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. Do you even try to make sense of the lyrics?
Or is it just
stuff that, you know, phonetic kind of thing?
I'm looking at the lyrics right now, and all I'm thinking is,
Well, do we want to go down that rabbit hole and turn this into an analysis of the Paul McCartney song? I personally don't.
No, but
I'm no, like, but just I'm the, not, just I'm the, not even the strawberry attention. Wine.
That was just a moment where I had to do
well,
a.
Well, yeah,
shoulder
you've
shrug.
Never heard any of this stuff no, before, yeah. So I would advise you to just tune it out. Don't even try. Focus on you know, and again. The format of this tribute album restricts our focus to the vocals of Gene and Paul. That's right. It.
Yeah, pretty much.
I'm not going to talk about fucking McCartney's backing band and how well they play the songs. Everybody knows how well they play the songs. They've been doing it for fucking 20 years now.
Yeah.
This is a really stupid format for a tribute album.
It is.
It's weak.
Yeah.
I didn't even know this, A, that this came out, and B, that this is how they did it.
I just wanted to bring up that the that using the term strawberry wine made me, of course, think of the Jermaine Stewart cherry wine.
Cherry wine, yeah.
And we don't have to take our clothes
exactly.
off.
Exactly.
All right. Time for a wild card mid-episode. Venus and Mars rock show slash
we don't have to take our clothes
yeah.
off.
Yeah.
In parentheses.
Venus and Mars are all right tonight.
Only thing I could think to contribute is that little keyboard, that smooth sounding kind of fluty keyboard sound sounds to me like very similar to what was also used in the beginning of Band on the Run. The
yeah, it's in that vein.
Yeah, I mean, it's just, it, you know, used it more than once. Why not? I don't know. There's a lot of eye rolling and things going on. I will have to agree that it's there's less excitement in listening to it because we're pretty sure it's not Kiss playing.
Well,
this.
We're 100% sure.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, we are.
Of course, they wouldn't. You know, they wouldn't bust out the Mellotron or whatever the fuck the
yeah.
instrument is. It's again, I don't get the format of this.
Yeah, I'm trying to wrap my head around it, but I don't really have a good answer.
As far as the song itself, it's a nice enough mellow song so far.
Well, it picks up steam when yeah. the second part kicks in, which
but
is
it's
good.
It's a nice, polite song so far.
It's a nice, polite song.
I mean, I know we don't want to go down the, you know, into the lyrics too much, but I mean, I don't know at all what Venus and Mars are all right tonight. I'm assuming it's a drug reference.
What else could it be?
What else could it be?
Or is it just some dumb...
That there's balance in the solar system?
You just say dumb shit because it's supposed to be...
I'm going to go with drug reference.
Yeah, I don't get it.
More often than not, that's what it ends up being anyway. Paul just killing this
he
right
is.
Now.
He is.
Yeah. And this was 2014, so is this the last actual like Kiss-credited song?
Is this after?
Oh, I thought it was.
On an actual, well, on an actual like release album.
Because Ascot doesn't
Ascot's
count.
Ascot's not on an album or anything like that, I don't believe.
And it probably is.
I guess so, huh? Oh, wait, what about Samurai Son? Was that before this or after this?
Oh, man. Now we got to...
I feel like we've done this before.
Now I got to tippy-tap the keyboard here.
If only we had a song that would help us find it.
Andy doesn't want to turn around.
I don't.
Though.
We don't have one. It'd be cool if we did. We don't.
Yeah, you look that up. We'll play more of the song.
What's that man moving across the stage? It looks a lot like a one used by Jimmy Page. It's like a relic from a different age. Could be
always enjoyed the name dropping of Jimmy Page and that lyric there. Mm. I mean, the image of Jimmy Page with that, the Les Paul slung down to his fucking knees, is as iconic as it gets in rock and roll. And we all know that Paul especially were disciples of Zeppelin.
Yeah.
So,
yep.
That's kind of cool. I'm sure he delivered that line with a little extra panache.
Yeah. Anything yet?
You know, no, not yet. I'm still trying to find the stupid...
Click, clack, click, clack.
Keep on going. If there's a rock show at the concert, the bow they
got. Long hair and nuts is where you got. Question. So that... This is already rock show, huh?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So Venus and Mars is short.
Yeah, it's just that little mellow intro.
This is a long-ass song, though.
And,
You know.
So it's like a minute and a half of one and five of the other.
Oh, boy.
I'll be damned.
And Samurai Sun is more recent. There you go.
Samurai
Sun. Was released the year after this.
Ridiculous song. Still can't believe that song. I have that on my phone. Comes on sometimes when I'm driving to work. I can't believe it. I usually listen to like a minute of it in disbelief. About that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, try to have McCartney's band do the Paul Stanley yodel for him.
That's right. It ain't gonna happen. Yeah, he had to put his signature on it
somewhere.
Absolutely. He did it. And again, 2014, this is, you know, if we want to talk about Paul's voice deteriorating over time.
Oh, he sounds great here.
He sounds great.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So, no problem with that.
But I heard he lip-synced when he was in the studio. Yeah.
It was to a track.
Yeah. That's all he ever does, right?
Damn it. Yeah. It just bothers me so much.
A la, maybe I'm amazed with the chromatic ascending.
Yeah, there's a lot of that in some Beatles songs.
Yeah.
I just can't. They're not coming to me, but it's a very Beatles-esque tactic.
Keep Yourself Alive comes to mind with the single note chromatic stuff.
Like right, that. Right, right. Yeah.
What was that line? Don't shoot until you see the whites
of their eyes.
Of whose eyes?
Oh,
perfect.
Yeah,
good stuff. Rock show at the concert, the bow you got. Long hair at Madison Square, they got. Rock and roll at the Hollywood Bowl. We'll be there. Rock and roll. We're going to the.
Yeah, I always hated this part.
And this was...
It's just reminding me after Andy's comment earlier, this song is way longer than it needs to be.
There's a lot
just
going
get
on.
Get it over.
There is a lot happening, a lot of changes.
Yeah, too much. Too much unnecessary shit
and
happening.
And that has the quality of the voice there. There's a certain quality to it. Of that eye. It's given me the whole Malcolm Young TNT kind of sound.
Right. Yeah, I think it lacks some balls.
I'm assuming that's predominantly Malcolm Young.
Probably.
Who did that backing vocal. But
yeah.
That's who I always associated it with.
Reminded me of the same thing, so I'm right there with you.
Preparing to shoot up the city.
Yeah.
And the end of my nose makes me look rather pretty. Yeah.
That's pretty. Again, I've never heard the original, but
the original, he does a very it's I'm sure on purpose. It's like a very obnoxious. I don't know. I'm not going to go into guessing what region of the UK it's supposed to be. Okay, I'm not going to just say I'll guess Cockney, but I could be wrong.
Sure.
But a very like over the top kind of obnoxious sounding thing.
The whole voice of that.
Yeah,
part?
Yeah, the whole voice of that part. So, I mean, you got Paul Stanley here. He's going to be Paul Stanley, the preacher, of course.
Right.
So it's pretty perfect in that regard.
Does the Paul McCartney version have that little noise after he said pretty?
I don't know. I don't remember
if not,
that much of it.
Familiar with it.
If not, hats off to Paul for adding that. He sounds very pleased with himself after he said
he
how pretty
be.
He looks.
He should be. He sounds great.
Yeah.
It's a pity there's nobody here to witness the end.
He really did it there.
See,
Paul Stanley'd it up right there. He knew it was okay.
Mm-hmm.
This is the time in the song where it's okay to do that.
So essentially, I mean, this isn't profound analysis, but essentially Rock Show is a tour promotional song.
Yeah.
We'll be there. Where's the rock and roll happening? That's where we're going.
So
look for us.
This is kind of like Kiss and Time or something.
Kind of, yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah, it really, you know, just, I mean, and there's some weirdness with Miss Kitty.
Yeah.
Or whatever that's all about.
Dusty Rhodes delivery.
See, that's another guy you could have got for that.
Yeah. Is that Tully Blanchard's valet at some point?
Miss Kitty. Yeah, it's a cool song, though. It's all over the place in certain parts. A lot of changes, but a cool song.
It's, you know, the British elements of it. Get it out of there.
You don't care for that British stuff.
It doesn't work for me.
That's why I don't like that.
All right, I've got to choose my words carefully. That's why the Beatles just haven't aged well for me. It's too British. I'm not interested in it. You know.
You know. I think that might have been my problem the whole time. I've never gotten into them. Still haven't.
That might be my problem with Pink Floyd, too. It's just too fucking British.
Never got into them either.
I can't relate to it. It's too stupid. It's like, I'm not interested in your fucking, the nuances of your fucking culture. I don't get it.
Yeah.
Jesus. Give me the bands that, you know, were overtly influenced by the American sound, being Zeppelin and the Stones, embraced, you know, blues and country music. Don't give me the fucking Monty Python of rock and roll.
I was just going to ask you that. Are you a Monty Python fan at all?
I mean, they're similar to the Beatles. I watched them a bit when I was young, and it amused me. But now it's like I would never even consider watching it.
You're more of a Benny Hill guy, right?
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Again, embracing this American slapstick style.
Yeah.
You know, fuck this. You know, whatever the British humor is, you know, there's none of that in Benny Hill. It's just, it's comedy from the groin area. It's like the music from the groin area. That's what I want.
Yeah.
Give me your goddamn British nuance. Fuck off with that.
Like when they named, let's see, I'm trying to think of a specific, Taxman when they, for whatever reason, decided to name a couple of current, at the time, current
parliamentarians or whatever. Yeah. The hell out of here with
that. See, that kind of thing doesn't age terribly well when you do that, when you throw in specific, like, you know, current political kind of things.
Yeah, it's that, just, you know, and again, you know, nobody gives a damn about your tax structure. Sing to me about that. Fuck off.
Chris wasn't done.
I know that little noise before the song kicked in. The best part of the show so
far. It's just, you know, the whole, it's just remind, you know, the, I don't know. I could go down a rabbit hole with that, but, you know, it's just the, just don't get it. And that's what that idiot Jeff Lynne tried to latch on to. It's like, you get the, it's bad enough when it comes from the source, but when this fucking asshole breezes in and tries to ride on those coattails, what a loser. Get out of here, idiot. Terrible.
I have to say, speaking of Monty Python, and I'm not that well-versed, like, I've never seen the movies.
You're not missing anything. But I've seen, contrary to what people will tell you on social media after they listen to this episode and come rushing to the defense of British people and Monty Python, get the fuck out. It's some of the most overrated stuff in entertainment history.
I mean, I've seen the show, and it's one of those shows where I'm just kind of like, I don't get any of this. And then there's a moment where I'm like hysterical. That was that was fantastic.
Yeah.
But the rest of it, I don't really get what's happening. And like when Benny Hill does his songs, he's usually going, it's so hard to understand him from with an American ear.
Right.
That there's a lot of that. There's a lot of, I don't know what's going on. And then something absolutely wonderful happens. There's a moment.
There's more wonderful in Benny Hill than there is Monty Python.
There's more lingerie in Benny Hill than anything
exactly
else.
Exactly right, yeah.
Slapping old guys on the back of the head.
Yeah, right.
Their hats fall
that
off.
That poor little old guy.
Yeah.
I sure hope they were able to get booked at all these venues on that tour.
Right. If not.
Say you're playing, you know, at the second big arena in town.
Yeah.
And you're singing about Madison Square.
Yeah. You're playing could over be, in Jersey.
Could be a
where
little,
the Devils
could,
play.
Could be an embarrassing
I'm
situation.
I'm pretty sure Paul McCartney has always been booked in Madison Square Garden since he embarked on his own.
Probably right.
I don't even. Did the Beatles ever play there? I mean, they could have. I'm just not sure if they played that particular venue.
You'd think
venue.
That if they did, it would be considered a legendary thing that we would have heard about a million times.
The only thing I ever heard of is Shea Stadium.
Right.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I don't know. Wasn't that not really a thing as much then? It's kind of in its infancy, right?
It was like the wrestling was there.
Right.
Not really
yeah,
really
the Rangers. And boxing was a big deal. You know? Knicks, basketball. But then, you know, the Zeppelin movie, the song remains the same from, what, 72, 73? That was filmed at Madison Square Garden. So maybe that's when it got started ramping up.
Yeah.
I mean, it had to have been a thing around 75 because he's singing about
of
it,
course.
Writing about it in the song. So must have been when it was on the rise. But, yeah, rest assured, Paul McCartney never went through those phases where he's playing the casino circuit, okay? That never happened to him.
He never had a down period where...
Not for, as a concert draw, because people show up, they want to hear the Beatles shit. They'll fill
forever,
in all eras,
absolutely.
Think, 80s, 90s.
That guy never slummed it. He's not Ringo, for Christ's sake.
He's not doing free summer festivals.
No. Well, I mean, he might have... I think he's probably done Summerfest in Milwaukee, which is technically free, but that's a massive...
That's a different thing.
Yeah. But no, he wasn't, you know, dicking around on the casino circuit or slumming it in any capacity. It's Paul friggin' McCartney.
Yeah. I'm trying to think, not that I really would know, but there's never been an era where Paul McCartney wasn't, like, top dog.
I don't know. You would think, like, in the
80s. I mean, in terms of, like, the stuff he was recording and releasing.
No, I know that was... That wasn't always top shelf material.
Well,
as far as
the other thing is he hasn't been constantly touring. But when he does, he fills the top arenas.
So maybe that's part of it, that he spaced it out
appropriately. He's not going to be playing at the Aragon Ballroom here in Chicago. And if he did, it would be an intentional thing to say, I played a small venue.
$5,000 a ticket.
It's like when the Stones played at the Double Door. They did a set
really?
There. Yeah.
Wow. When was that? A long time ago?
Mid to late 90s, I think. It was like what?
Was it announced?
It was announced like 2 hours before the show.
Wow. But know anybody who went?
Me personally? No.
Yeah, no.
I don't think so. I'm sure. I probably would. I mean, you know, I don't know of anybody I know was there, but I'm sure somebody I know was there.
That was your scene during your era, so someone probably was wrong.
I think you could probably look that up to see what the date was, but you know, they did like a warm-up show at a tiny little venue in Chicago.
I saw the New York Dolls there.
Yeah, that must
pretty
be
cool.
Good.
Yeah, that's cool. I don't know. Isn't that a Rolling Stones thing? I don't know if they still do that, but for a lot of years they would do smaller clubs and like unannounced gigs at bars or someone from the
under
band.
A different name.
Yeah.
Like a silly, different
right.
band name.
Or a guy or two would show up at some blues guy's show and do songs with their band.
Well, and, you know, Nick's favorite artist, Prince, was known for that. Playing.
He was too.
Like after hours shows after his gig in town, he'd go to like, you know, here in Chicago would be Metro or House of Blues and play to like the dawn, play a 4 hour set.
That's crazy.
Yeah. He was pretty legendary doing that. Like the thing would be if Prince is playing in town, let's find out where the after hours show is.
Okay. I didn't know that.
Yeah. He was pretty well known for that. Guy was prolific, man.
I guess so. He liked to play.
He sure did.
He had potential.
Yeah, I know. His potential snuffed out by those pharmaceuticals.
Yeah.
Here they go again.
It's not over.
Who's that there? Oh, it's you, babe. Come on now. We're going down to the rock show.
Might be the first time Paul Stanley ever said.
Just about to say, he's
put
usually
your clothes on.
He's usually advocating the opposite trajectory.
Yeah, that implies that the dress was off, though.
That's true. it's more Paul Stanley than we thought originally.
Yeah. Is that in the original song?
Girl, you can't go out the way that you are right now.
The way I like to have you.
The way I just made you.
Yeah. Right. Is that in the original?
I think so.
Your dress
I can't recall.
Yeah, we'll say Paul Stanley.
Yeah, I'm not versed.
I have the Wingspan double disc, so I know most of those songs. I don't think this one's on it though. Mm.
Place your wig on straight. We can't be late. Come on, we got a date. We're going to the red show.
Kind of hesitated there. It's weird.
Well, it's
going to the
rock
show.
That's Paul Stanley.
He almost let slip and said sex club by accident.
The daggering club.
Yeah, exactly. You're going to be drawn and quartered in front of a room full of perverts. figuratively speaking. Right. You won't actually be killed, but you will be.
But there will be pervs.
Publicly humiliated, flogged, all of that shit.
Lot happening here.
Totally unnecessary. Very British.
He went into his sort of reggae. There's a Obla Da was a little up tempo kind of reggae groove to it.
Yeah, kind of.
And Live and Let Die had that little section where it busted into a little reggae kind of thing, and so did this song. So. Which that the Guns N' Roses version of Live and Let Die, when it goes into that section, it's like, for whatever reason, it's always been like goosebump kind of thing.
Really?
Like it somehow it culminates into that part, and it's just perfect the way that they did it. And it doesn't have the weird duck sounds like the McCartney version.
They left the duck at home.
Yeah.
Guns N' Roses said duck.
I mean, I just remember when that video used to be on, and I was younger. Just that part.
The Guns N' Roses.
Yeah. The way that Guns N' Roses pulled off that little interlude.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they kind of. I won't say they did it all the way, but they almost took ownership of that song, which is not easy.
Yeah.
That particular song, but you wouldn't think that they would do such a great version of it, but they really did.
You got Slash there, you might as well have him take it over.
Yeah.
Which is what he did.
That is true. And you know what else is true? It's that time of the show where we exercise our right to vote. Hell or hallelujah. Guys, who wants to go first?
I'll go.
All right. So now that you're at the voting booth, would you like to come see my football sometime? I don't think we talked about that.
No, we didn't, but that's...
I thought you did.
I think it was just in person. I don't think it was on the
private
show.
Private message, yeah.
But when I went to vote on voting day, I was in line for like 10 minutes, and this guy, you know, obviously he lives near me. It's the district, you know, and he's like, oh, you got to come by sometime and check out my footballs. I've got this great collection of footballs.
And then...
Like, okay.
Yeah.
I'm thinking about going.
And you haven't gone?
No, not yet.
He might not have it on the table anymore.
Yeah,
for you.
He might have taken it back. Damn it.
Word has probably gotten around that there's a guy who doesn't want to see the footballs for some reason.
Yeah, that's a bad reputation to
Did
have
you
in
hear
town.
That? You hear that guy?
The Jones boy.
The Jones guy. He's got some kind of problem with going to see the footballs.
With Wally's footballs. All right, well, I'm sorry for interrupting.
Oh,
Nick,
no.
Hell or hallelujah?
Like I most likely would give the football collection a hallelujah. it's a cool song. It's if you're in one of those moods where you don't want just a straight song with a couple of parts being repetitive, it's pretty satisfying in that regard. It's not going to keep you bored, that's for sure.
Yeah.
And it's Paul McCartney, so every part is very musical and very catchy and all that kind of stuff. So, cool song. Gene sounded pretty good in the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you can tell it was a little bit out of his comfort zone at this point. Just like the way that it was almost like he was the Ascot voice slightly, but obviously not as exaggerated and comical. But then when Paul came in, it was like, okay, this is how it should be.
Yeah.
Like I, you know, McCartney, of course, great rock and roll voice when he would amp it up like that, you know, could get the gravelly sound, could do all that stuff. But, I'd have to listen to him back to back to see if he could top the Paul Stanley vocal on this. I kind of doubt it because it just seems like it's perfect for Mr. Stanley. So yeah, I enjoyed it. Bit of silliness, but you know, whatever.
Sure,
why not? So yeah,
Chris,
hallelujah.
Where are you at?
I'm gonna have to, just for Paul's vocal performance, could tell he was fully engaged and into it. Give it a very slight hallelujah. I mean, that's really it. I mean, again, it's like there's nothing interesting or outside the box happening musically or with the arrangement. It's just, you know, due to the format. So, you know, but Paul, like Nick said, he sounds great. He's really bringing it on this one. So that tipped the scales over to Hallelujah Land for me.
Andy.
It's a clean sweep, guys. Hallelujah.
Oh, goodness.
Again, first time hearing this song. I liked it. I didn't think I was going to like it. I don't know why I have this preconceived notion that I can't possibly like Wings, and I barely can tolerate the Beatles after their first year or two. I don't know why. I'm not ruling it out that I'll never like that stuff, but it just has never...
And you've given it chances,
I've
right?
given it yeah. a couple chances, and it's just yeah. never been my thing.
I've done that with certain bands, certain artists. Yeah. I'll go back a couple of times,
yeah,
and I'm just like, no, it's not...
I feel like I'm supposed to like this.
Like, you know, and this is one of Andy's guys, but for me, Bowie,
yeah,
I just can't. Like, can't. There's not much there that I'm like... We're going to fly the flag for
well, us. And it's another, to tee off on Andy, gang up on him, another one of his guys, that. Faith No More. It's like the Angel Dust album, just seemingly universally worshipped, but when songs from that album come up on shuffle on my iPod, I'm just like, I don't get this.
Really?
What's so great about this?
Everything? I don't know.
Yeah, it's not hitting it for me. And the only reason I have it is because some guy we know was moving out west and he didn't want to bring all his CDs with him. And yeah. he posted on Facebook that anybody who wanted him could come pick them up. And I'm just like, sure, I'll go grab those and rip some of my library. Yeah. Probably got some good stuff in there. And he did. But, you know, I saw Angel Dust in there. I'm like, all right, let's see what all the fuss is about. I just don't get it.
Hmm. That's unfortunate,
yeah,
but I respect
just
your
completely
opinion.
Lost on me.
Got it. Mental note. Maybe we'll explore that some other time.
Oh, yeah. My.
Anyway, yeah, I didn't think I would like this song. I did like it. I liked it a lot. You know, maybe Paul Stanley should redo all the Beatles songs and make them good. What do you guys
all
think?
All the Wing songs.
All the Wing songs, too.
Can you imagine him singing silly love songs? That would be interesting.
What about some of that stuff on Shaved Fish?
There you go.
We had that out on the record, on the turntable two weeks ago, something like that. How about some of that from Paul Stanley? I think he could have saved that. He could have made it good.
He's got a lot going on, though.
Yeah, I guess he's too busy.
There's a track on there that Jean Beauvoir would be good on, I think.
Are you saying he's the only one who could get away with it these days?
Well, who knows?
That would be inappropriate for Paul Stanley
to
sing.
That's the thing.
Possibly.
Could you get away with that, saying you're doing a Lennon cover?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Excuse.
People are so sensitive nowadays.
I think you can use that as an excuse, depending on who you are.
I don't think anyone could do it.
Can you do the Sly Stone song?
No.
Don't Call Me Whitey?
No.
No, you can't.
Can't do that, no matter who
it's
you are.
It's off limits.
Even if you're one of the darlings of...
Like a five-finger death punch came up and did Don't Call Me Blankety-Blank Whitey. Yeah, they wouldn't get a pass for that. Their careers would be over.
I wish
they
would
try.
Which
would not be a bad thing.
Not even John Mayer could do it?
He might be able to pull it off.
Okay, we got one guy.
He's the guy. He's got one foot in each world. He can pull it off. I don't know. Yeah, that's... I just don't think...
A John Legend, John Mayer duet.
Oh, there you go. See, that could work.
Those are two people who can do no wrong in the eyes of many.
And then get John Legend's wife to tweet something about it.
Oh,
we're all set. Everyone
exactly.
will love it.
They'll be selling it at Target on the end cap.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm trying to think... Because the idea behind that song is a nice sentiment, I guess. I mean, nice was probably the wrong word, but you know what I mean.
It's not very pleasant, but
no,
yeah.
It's not pleasant at all. But the point of what he's trying to make—he's
talking about an oppressed
Yes.
People. Well, right.
Yeah,
but raising awareness. Clearly he's doing, did it, he had shock value in mind.
Absolutely. But my point is, I don't think in 2018 that anyone cares about context anymore. It's more just about
what you... He never did.
Well, but I mean, he got away with it. If you did it now, it would be, oh, you said this. It wouldn't be why you said it. Right, it's just that you said it.
Nobody could do the opening track of the Randy Newman Good Old Boys album these days.
I don't know what it is, but
I
bet
you... what it is.
It's called Rednecks and...
No, they're fair game.
Oh no, but the
there's and another word.
There's the word that we're referring to being used quite often.
Jeez.
That and if you want a weird song,
sort of a twist on Ebony and Ivory.
The original title. Yeah. That was the demo.
Yeah, that
for
was
it.
Yeah. And the demo was better in that case.
Wow. Okay. Well.
Yeah, let's get this next round over with. I think we...
Yeah,
there's no suspense here, is there?
No, there's none.
Just play it.
Do a
little bit of the drum intro. Okay. Just end it.
All right, sure. Let's do this.
Let's get...
All right, Hammond! I got a question for you.
Paul Stanley wants to know... If Venus and Mars / Rock Show is a Stone Cold Kiss classic?
It isn't.
The answer is no. Not good.
Boop.
Well, Andy's computer died. Okay.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it very much, but I mean, there's the fact that it's not actually a Kiss per se recording.
Yeah.
Even though it's listed that way.
Yeah,
that has something to do with it. And if I didn't give the, if I shot down the Ramones one, I couldn't put this one up there.
Yeah,
because the Ramones one was a much harder decision.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I doubt anyone disagrees with us, but if you do, I'm sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
Yeah. But you know what? We all agree on what time it is.
Sing away.
Baseball time.
Yes, Chief.
All right.
I was actually going to ask, was that when we shot down the song in the second round, was that Pierre or your brother yelling at the TV sports contest on? Yeah. Listen to it again.
Yeah.
It's not as cut and dry as you would think. No. Play it. Listen to it again. Is this Pierre or Jay Jones yelling at the TV?
You can never be too sure.
Give it a listen.
Actually sounds a lot like him.
Yeah, exactly.
And,
very impassioned. Either way.
He ain't even touch him!
Alright.
Yeah.
Alright. So, guys, Yardo question. This week's Yardo questions comes to us from Tim Fielder.
I recognize that name.
Alright. I like his format here, so we're going to run with
it.
I'm not going to preview the questions.
See, it's like a resume.
Tim
made it appealing to the eye.
Mm-hmm.
That gets the foot in the door.
It looks like he put some thought into these questions, formatted nicely, spaced nicely. I'm in. Thank you, Tim. Here we go. Question one. Has Chris had a run-in with an Australian at some stage? He seems very down on us, including our curly-whirly chocolates, and the fact that thongs, flip-flops, are considered a national footwear here. On behalf of Australia, to whoever has pissed Chris off, fuck you, you flaming gala. I don't know that word. G-A-L-A-H. Must be
that's got to be extremely derogatory.
Well, first of all, the thong thing that he just described, that immediately cast your whole country into question. Certainly casts the manliness of your male citizens into question.
Yeah.
Okay? Reevaluate what you're doing down there.
Both down there on that part of the world and on your feet.
Right. I mean, I don't know. I can't really pinpoint why I've gunned down Australians on the show in the past, but I don't really know any Australians. Do you?
I don't know any. I've talked to one that I could think of. It was like a work-related thing. There was a guy from Australia, and I had a moment where it was just me and him, and chit-chat happened. But no, I don't actually know any.
Do you, Andy?
No, I don't. Yeah. I mean, just listeners. But personally, like, I've never... I don't think I've even met somebody from Australia before.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, see, something you got to understand about what we're trying to do on this show is just... You got to say stupid, outrageous shit just for the sake of doing it to get a rise out of people. We're provocateurs.
Yeah. Nick, when you met this or talked to this Australian person, how long until you brought up Paul Hogan?
It didn't. It actually didn't happen at all.
Oh, okay.
I think all I did was mispronounce some cities.
Okay.
I think I said Brisbane.
And he called you a jerk.
I think it's Brisbane, you know, obviously.
Yeah. At what point did you chase him out of the room with repeated references to shrimp on the barbecue?
I asked him if he wanted to go to Outback.
Yeah, exactly. That's one thing I will come to the defense of Australians. The voiceover guy they have on the Outback steakhouse chain of restaurants here in America is as pandering and insulting and stereotyping of a group of people as you'll ever hear.
I think,
but again, gets a pass because these people are white.
Yeah.
I think, I mean, there's...
Most Australians are white, correct?
Or
except for the Aborigines, And the koalas. They're more like gray.
A fair amount of white on them, too, though.
Yeah, they're more gray, in my opinion.
Yeah, those commercials are like an Australian minstrel show.
Yeah, it really is. It's just, well, I will defend the Australians.
See,
on
that's
that.
A good point. You don't see Amos and Andy TV shows in syndication.
No.
You don't have Speedy Gonzalez on TV very much these days.
Questionable scenes from Tom and Jerry cartoons have been removed.
Any of the World War II, with the unfortunate Japanese stereotypes going
stuff?
On. Looney Tunes, Disney even.
Oh, yeah.
You don't see that unless you
Wasn't
go...
Wasn't there Mickey Rooney one, too?
Well, yeah, that was
any of that?
Breakfast at Tiffany's.
Oh, that's from that. Okay. Yeah.
Is that those scenes have been eradicated from that movie?
I don't think that one has. No,
that one hasn't made it yet.
There's it's been
Christmas
on and
Story.
What's
the ending scene of A Christmas Story?
Oh, with the fa ra ra ra.
Yeah, isn't that over with?
Well,
now?
You know what?
Well, they should use that an excuse to get rid of that movie altogether. That's another one. It's kind of like the Beatles of music for Andy. It's like, I feel like I should watch this and enjoy it because so many people talk about it and worship it. I finally got around to watching it maybe two Christmas seasons ago. What a stupid movie.
You're not allowed to say that. You live here now.
Damn.
It's our regional
guess
piece
what?
Of
hang
art.
Hang your hat on something else. It's a shit movie. Stupid.
Next question?
Yeah, I was going to go further down. That,
go ahead.
Go ahead, quickly.
Okay, I was just going to say, I think that's still acceptable for some reason, the L and R confusion.
I don't know. Did you see the Christmas Story Live that they did last year, 2 years ago, or whatever that was?
No, I
happened. They cut it out.
They did where they were very, I don't know if eloquent is an insulting word, but like, their American accents were perfect, and then it was like a direct look into the camera, like, see?
Like,
we don't all sound like that. Like and they did a whole thing. Like, they even made some kind of statement, too, during that scene. Like, why not just cut the scene?
I mean, that's a thing.
Exactly.
That's a thing you hear in the workplace. Like, I do, at least.
Your workplace is unlike most other people's.
I'm just saying, that's the kind of joke that you
print
still
out and
hear.
Put on the fridge at work?
No, but someone will stand up and make the joke to the office.
Yeah.
Right. Well, like, that's the kind of joke that you'll that someone will do with full confidence that
really?
There won't
still?
Be any sort of consequence.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
And it's
the
no
tide is slowly changing, but yeah, you can you won't your whole life won't be destroyed if you drop that ridiculous euphemism yeah. or caricature and mixed company.
Not for long.
Well, the tide is changing, like I said, but as of this moment, your life will not be nuked if you went down that road. Not saying you should, but
no, it's not. It's not acceptable yet. It is so.
Right. All right. Question two: how many times have you guys watched the Scooby-Doo Kiss movie?
My zero. Little,
a lot.
My little girl is obsessed with it to the point that she demands the Scooby-Doo rocket ship guitar. I was made ... song in the car. Or the Destroyer song, Detroit Rock City, when she has had enough of the last song. Nick, does that sound familiar to you?
I know exactly every single detail of what he's talking about.
So you're in the same boat.
I've seen it many times, and it is a gateway. I guess I'll just use the cliche. It's a gateway drug.
Yeah.
For kids to get in. I mean, my kids are into a lot of different Kiss songs now.
Because of that movie.
Because of that movie initially, yeah.
So, mission accomplished to Kiss.
Yeah, yeah, that's
a strategic
sure.
win on their part.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's absolutely. We have a YouTube playlist,
mm-hmm.
and those clips are on there. We've got the. I think it's Spanish. I don't know if someone ripped it from a Spanish overdubbed version or something. The part of the dialogue is in Spanish.
And then the song starts.
Yeah.
Like, it's like a couple sentences or something.
Yeah. So it's, I know exactly. And I've seen it many times. And it's great.
Yeah. I don't have kids, so for me, it's a big fat zero.
I watched it once, and I did like it. I thought it was better than I thought it would be. It's pretty well made, and it's. And we may have talked about this, but I thought, oh, this is what Kiss meets the Phantom of the Park should have been.
That had to be the conscious drive behind it.
Yeah, because it's similar theme, but it's not as stupid.
And it's
way more Kiss centric too.
Yeah, and there's a lot of humor in it.
Yeah,
yeah. So it's really good. They did a really good job on it.
Much better than that movie. All right, question three. Not a question, just a thank you. Listening to you guys ramble about a single song for the past few years while I walk my dog has been really enjoyable and a lot of fun to listen to.
I heard down there they walk the dogs the other direction.
Does that mean they go backwards?
They put the leash around the back side of the dog.
And they walk backwards?
Yeah.
I don't know.
I heard also that all the dogs down there are, in fact, prisoners.
Oh, that too.
Yeah, they're turning Australia back into a penal colony, but for dogs. Dogs that have committed crimes are banished to Australia.
So, like, any dogs in a dog fighting ring are sent down there?
Yes, exactly.
You've really brought my love of Kiss back, and my little girl has caught on, too.
Well, Kiss can feel free to cut us a check for that privilege. I know they're listening, so yeah, get your pens out.
Yeah.
Cut us a check.
Add a zero.
And not one of these fucking Spotify level checks. We want something substantial.
Yeah, that's
holidays are coming up.
Yeah. Don't cut me no $1.50 Spotify check for 2 million plays or streams.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna cut it for us.
Nope. And my little girl has caught on too now that I've been playing the tunes around the house more often. Thanks, guys. Take it easy. Well played. You guys get a hallelujah from me, Tim from Melbourne, Australia, which I believe is also pronounced
Melbourne.
No, I think they say Melbourne.
Oh, good for them.
Yeah. Yep, I believe that's. If you say Melbourne, you're like. That's like when someone says something with a southern accent. You're like, what?
I know this is a different part of the world, but I pretty much always intentionally say Worcestershire sauce.
Because
I'm not going to try to shorten it.
I've just stopped eating it altogether.
I haven't had that in a long time. It's good. I like it. But
just for
like,
the
what
name.
Do you put it on anymore?
Steak. I don't know what else.
I mean, how
it's
many?
It's too watery for steak. First of all,
it's good for mixing in if you're making something where you it's an ingredient. That's
yeah,
the
right.
only time I ever use it.
Yeah.
Put one on my next steak at Outback.
There you go. That makes sense.
Yeah.
All right, well, Tim, thank you. I don't know. Do you guys have any comments on since he
I was about
have a question,
to s- I was about to say that this guy went from fuck you to thank you in the span of three questions. So that's impressive. That's not happened before.
Well, I don't know. He wasn't saying it to you in the first question.
He kind of was.
Yeah. No, he said on behalf of Australia.
Yeah. To fuck who, me.
No, to whoever has pissed Chris off.
Oh,
fuck you.
See, I took that as at right. Chris, and I liked it better that way, actually.
Sorry for ruining it.
Well, it turns out it is against me because nobody's pissed me off.
Yeah, I guess you're right. Okay. You
just pissed
yourself off.
Just attacking the country for no reason.
Yeah.
Just part of the fun. But
can you imagine going there? Unbelievable. I was actually talking about that with my wife. Like, oh, that'd be fun to go if it didn't take 22 hours on a plane.
It's
like impossible.
It will never happen.
It's literally beyond the other side of the planet. Just, you know.
It'd be incredible to check it out, but there's no way in hell.
What yeah, if, I'm not
what if you went
in
the area
hours.
You went to? You were
it's just
like
here?
Yeah, it's like, all right.
There better be a kangaroo. There better be a dingo.
You're not going to see it. You might see a dingo.
A guy better have a croc tooth hat on. Yeah.
Somebody playing a didgeridoo or
better
whatever the fuck
better
that
happen.
Is.
Is there, we were talking about Paul Hogan earlier. Is there an American equivalent of somebody who, you know, like a Yahoo Sirius or a Paul Hogan?
Yeah.
Somebody Sirius. Who came here and, you know, had their moment of...
That's a great question.
Is there somebody
but like
that was an American entertainer that went there and was like maybe a movie or two or whatever?
Yeah.
Some kind of huge, just took the whole continent by storm.
But it would have to be someone who wasn't necessarily huge here, right?
Right.
I guess,
became huger over there.
Yeah. I mean, you could say Kiss did that with Shandy, but Kiss was huge here.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know who we'd have to... I guess we'd have to open
we'll
this
ask
up to,
Tim.
Our Austra- to Tim and our other Australian
listeners. Are there
listeners.
Any... When you bring up American entertainers, is there a... is there someone that's... I won't be mean and say, like, a joke amongst the people. But, you know, a short-lived...
I could see them being really into Harry Anderson.
Maybe.
Big Night Court crowd over there.
Or the guy who played Screech on Saved by the Bell.
There has to be somebody who went there and had a show or something. At least a live performance.
And whose shtick down there is just a ridiculous caricature of an American, and people
right.
just love it.
That's the other key part.
And it would have to be a Southerner, most likely. To
it has
do
to be a cowboy.
To do an American
right?
caricature, yeah.
Yeah.
You think they like Larry the Cable Guy down there?
They might love him.
Probably.
That would be good.
He'd fit right in down there.
He would.
His cut-off shirts and his stupid hats and...
Do you ever watch any Larry the Cable Guy stand-up?
No.
Okay, so I never really did either.
Is it
I've watched,
decent?
I watched like 2 minutes of a special that was where the Nebraska Cornhuskers play football in that big-ass
yeah.
stadium he was performing
right.
there. And it was filled with people. And I was like, oh, this is going to be horrible. I can't believe this many idiots went to go see this guy. In like 30 seconds, I laughed a couple times. I'm like, this isn't bad.
Well, he's...
That's kind of... You know how I feel about George Lopez's
stand-up. Yeah.
It's the same way. I think he probably gets a bad rap just for other stuff he's done.
And yeah.
Larry the Cable Guy, just his whole image.
Yeah.
But I can see the possibility of that. It's not something that I would... willingly tune in on, but
right.
if I accidentally happened upon it, I could see it being.
That's exactly what it was.
Me.
I'm like, this guy's got to be the worst.
Well,
catchphrase
isn't
garbage.
He doesn't even have an accent.
I don't think he
when
really
he speaks
does.
Normally.
I think he's just a character.
Yeah.
Oh, an act.
Yeah. But it was actually like he said a couple things that made me laugh out loud. I'm like, all right.
Yeah. I mean,
I'll
it's
be
all
damned,
it takes.
Larry.
If
you
somebody can make you do that, they got something. They're doing something.
And
right.
it's funny how rare that is.
Yeah.
If you're watching TV. Rare.
Yeah.
That
it's true, yeah.
That never really happened, like, cuz I watched so many sitcoms that
right.
were current like growing up in the 90s and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
It was rare that I would laugh out loud at something.
Yeah, that's true. Well, I remember one of the opening lines, and of course I'm not going to say it the same way, accent or exact words, but, you know, he's in this giant stadium that's sold out with whatever that seats, 50, 60,000 people or something like that. And he's, like, commenting on how many people are there, and he's like, well, if you ever wanted to go shopping at Walmart, now's the time. I think that's pretty funny because he's making fun of himself and everyone else in the audience. All right, so that got me, and then he said a couple more things that started making me laugh. I'm like, this guy, it's not so bad. Yeah, shouldn't be such a dick.
Don't be.
And judge everything based on what I think is.
Everybody does it.
I know.
You know, don't be tricked by people who say they don't do it. Everybody does it. Everybody sizes up other people.
Yeah, right.
100% of human beings do it.
Yep. That's true, guys. That's true. Well, I have a question. How many episodes are left, Pot of Thunder?
Three.
Here? We only have three more episodes, and then...
It's over!
That's it. Three more. Oh, my God. What's left? I don't even know. I don't actually don't know without looking at the website. I have no...
Yeah, go look at the website.
Go look at potofthunder.com.
I know two.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know all three.
You do?
Yeah.
Do you want to tell us?
No.
No? Okay. Well, fine.
Yeah.
I'm not going to look at it.
I want people to think that maybe there's songs that we've done already that are still on.
Okay. Fine. Fine, man.
I want to be difficult.
Well, mission accomplished, yeah. Nick. You're being difficult. But yeah, that's pretty unbelievable. Three more to go.
The Banoffee has emboldened me.
Yes, it has.
Yeah. I think you run this place. You have a little Banoffee. Pulled his pants down. His bare ass on my couch.
Well,
he doesn't care.
It's not the first time.
No, it's not. Yeah, so again, mark your calendars, ladies and gentlemen. December 17th, the final Kiss song here on Pot of Thunder. Ooh, what's it going to be? There's only three left. Can people still get in on the challenge? No, right?
No.
That would be bullshit.
Months ago.
That'd be months. Yeah, because you... exponentially goes up.
They had their chance. They had the chance.
And the winner gets what? They get to talk to us or
they
something?
Get to be a guest on a future episode.
Wow, how's that going to work? There aren't any more.
How many future episodes are there?
We don't know. We got to figure out what's going to happen.
Nobody, I never guaranteed there would be any future episode. You asked what the prize was. That's it.
That's it. Okay.
That does not necessarily mean there will be any future episodes.
Yeah. We don't know. Future episode of what?
Yeah.
Might be something totally different. Who knows? Pretty exciting, though. But, yeah, you guys still have time to get your gifts in, your farewell Pot of Thunder gifts to sent over to the house, and we can open them live on the show.
Yeah, do it early, TikTok.
And thank you publicly, which is what you really want. You know, and they say sometimes the best gift is the gift of giving. So if you really want to...
Not sometimes, all the time.
That's right.
Everybody knows it.
That's right. So if you want to have a great holiday, whatever you celebrate come late December, go ahead and send us a gift, and you'll have the best holiday you've ever had. Right?
Guaranteed.
Isn't that how we're guaranteed. We'll talk about it. We'll thank you. We'll put a picture online. It's going to be awesome. Everything you've ever wanted. Your dreams come true here on Pod of Thunder. Maybe it'll happen next week. We'll find out.
Ooh, I just want to marry the podcast. I just want to marry the podcast. I just want to marry the podcast. Gonna go down on my knee and ask that podcast to marry me.
He had the Banoffee when he was a teenager.
He was born with a Banoffee spoon. Yeah, you mix it in hot milk. Yeah.